Now, Professor Rajashekar, let's hear about the experience at Lutheran Theological.
Thank you. Though I represent the Lutheran Theological Seminary and the Lutheran tradition in general, my remarks are based upon my own biographical background and experiences. I want to make that clear. The issue that we're all wrestling with is not new to me personally. As a person who was raised in India, the challenge of religious pluralism is something that I was born into and lived through and wrestled with all through my life. As an Indian Christian in a predominantly Hindu India, I had to learn to negotiate my own religious identity, not over against other religious traditions that I had to encounter in daily life, especially Hindus and Muslims and occasionally Buddhists, but I have to learn to understand them in a very relational terms. Most of my friends were Hindus and Muslims and few Buddhists. We played together, studied together, watched movies together, we walked together, and occasionally we ate in one another's homes. But there's one thing that we never did. We never prayed together. And that is one question that has always haunted me. I have always reflected about the deep division among us. We could do all sorts of things together, but when it comes to approaching the transcendent reality, or the divine, or God, if you will, we parted ways into our own segregated communities. So that's my personal background. Having taught about 25 years at the Lutheran Theological Seminary, and prior to that, I lived in Europe promoting interreligious dialogue at the international level, it has been part of my mission and emphasis to help students understand religious pluralism in the American context. The most important thing I've tried to impress upon them is that the religious pluralism in our midst is here to stay and cannot be wished away. While most of our students understand what I mean, few had the background or the experience or even the knowledge of other religious faiths to really appreciate the promise of religious pluralism in our midst. This is the important thing. Recognition of religious diversity and plurality in our midst, implicitly or explicitly, challenges the validity of the claims that each faith makes for itself. To put differently, the fundamental question of religious pluralism is that by what authority do you, a person of faith, make such and such a claim for yourself? And this is the most crucial question of religious pluralism, which demands accountability to one another. As you know, every religious tradition by nature or history tends to make exclusive claims about its uniqueness or particularity. This is necessary for a variety of historical, theological, and sociological reasons. Faiths have a tendency to uphold their particularity over against others, but seldom in relation to them. The logic of each faith requires that it articulates its faith, values, and commitments in relation to its own scripture, canon, tradition, dogma, and community. This is necessary and crucial for the integrity of the faith, of that faith in community. But pluralism, in my own religious experience, challenges the self-sufficiency of each and every faith and interrogates all claims for their adequacy and relevance in a pluralistic society. Interreligious engagement, if we take it seriously, calls for accountability of all our faith claims, not within the confines of our own tradition and community, but rather publicly. We are accountable to the other for what we claim to be our particularity. Thus, interreligious engagement is an inevitable aspect of contemporary life. Now, what does that mean for theological education? Long time ago, Max Müller, the famous Indologist, said, "Anyone who knows one religion knows none." We all prepare future leaders of our community, and therefore our students need to be well acquainted about the beliefs and values of the community that they serve. The bishop mentioned about how Catholic students are passionate about their own faith. This not only means that an awareness and knowledge of other faiths in community, but also the knowledge and skills necessary to engage with others without denigrating the faith and values of others. Interreligious engagement in a pluralistic society means that we learn to be guests in the midst of others. We know ourselves from within, from the inside, and all others from the outside. Given that reality, the curriculum at the Lutheran Theological Seminary requires that students take at least one course on interfaith engagement prior to graduation. We have been doing it for over 20, 25 years now. We offer also an interfaith concentration in the MDU program. We offer courses in the theory and practice of interreligious dialogue, Christian-Muslim relations, Christian-Jewish dialogue, and we have relationship with Nancy. We have courses jointly offered by RRC and the Lutheran Theological Seminary, courses in the theologies of religions, Christian scriptures in a multi-scriptural society, so on and so forth. Needless to say, some of our students have a lot of fear and trepidation to engage in dialogue or conversation with people of other faiths. Right at the, as soon as new students come in, we have a seminar on public theology that all students have to take. And right at the beginning, we expose them to the reality of religious pluralism and taking students to the mosques and the Hare Krishna temple, which is across from the seminary, the Buddhist center in Glenside, and we have presentations from religious leaders of the other communities in that program. So some students still have difficulty approaching the other because of their background, and you know, in spite of that exposure, they do not even know how to talk to persons of another faith. So a lot of them are disturbed by the kinds of theological questions interreligious engagement raises. It's not so much what we do at the seminary that matters in the end. We can teach them all the theory and practice of interreligious dialogue. Sometimes it doesn't stick. It's only when they enter the Christian ministry and engage in conversation with the leaders in that community that they begin to realize the importance of interfaith engagement. So the formation in interfaith education takes place not so much at the ministry, at seminary, but in the context of ministry. Interfaith education happens in ministry, not simply as a theoretical. So that said, I want to make one quick remark. We can engage in interreligious dialogue, can, you know, engage in justice involvement, common efforts, and so forth. Ultimately, the theological questions have to be addressed, which I don't have time to talk about. Most Protestant theological traditions were formulated in culturally and religiously circumscribed contexts of Northern Europe. And therefore, our inherited theologies are deficient, are highly problematic in their assumptions about other faiths. The captivity of our inherited theologies and prejudices is the greatest barrier in our engagement with religious pluralism today. Theological education today requires that we re-examine our inherited assumptions and theologies in relation to the reality of religious pluralism. And quickly, the Lutheran theological tradition has begun to revisit our theological heritage about its past assumptions and to find ways to reconceptualize its theological self-understanding in relation to religious pluralism. As some of you know, Lutherans have publicly repudiated the anti-Semitic aspects of Luther uttered in the 16th century. We have begun to articulate a dialogical understanding of our faith and produce a lot of resources to help educate our members and seminarians about their own faith in relational terms. A couple of months ago, we, the church as a whole, published a book on interreligious engagement entitled Engaging Others and Knowing Ourselves, a Lutheran calling in a multi-religious world. And in terms of Lutheran theological seminaries involvement in interreligious education, there is a major article that I did some years ago. There is a book produced by the Hartford Theological Seminaries, Pedagogies of Interfaith Dialogue, that tells all the details about how Lutheran Seminary introduced interfaith education. So I don't want to repeat that. Thank you so much.